Today we're going to talk about Docker for a couple different reasons. One of them being that Docker and containerization in general are becoming more and more prevalent and the architectures that people are working in AWS, or if you ship something to DigitalOcean, they're just very important to be able to do this, but it's also incredibly important in our development environments. And as I go through tutorials in the future, I want to be able to use Docker images in order to ship code as a starting point for some of the applications and projects that we're going to look into. I'm going to take this standpoint from working on a Mac, and we're going to go from start to finish to installing Docker and working with some Docker images that already exist to creating Docker containers and understanding what it's like for us to create our own images and then share those with the public. We're going to get started using the Docker for Mac, which is a new application that it can be installed into the slash applications directory. And there's also a equivalent version for Windows. If you're working on Linux, you don't actually have to worry about either of these things because Linux can support it natively. So for this, I already have Docker for Mac downloaded, and I'm going to move over here and just install this. In order to do this, I had to uninstall everything I had on my system so that we could make this as thorough and realistic as possible. So just drag and drop. And now we're going to run Docker for Mac. There it is. So you do have to allow this to use some networking privileges. So you have to be an admin user or a sudoer to be able to do this. But it's going to get you set up pretty fast. So it goes on and does its own thing here. But this will give us a couple different tools. And we'll just watch this. So it is currently running. This will give us Docker, the command line utility. It's going to run Docker, the server, for us. And then it's going to create a VM that it's actually running the Docker server on. And from there, it'll also give us Docker Compose, which is an orchestration tool that I'm not going to get into at all today, but I will in future videos, just because that's so useful from a development standpoint. So if I type Docker, it gave us this utility. If I look at Docker and look at the version, this is the newest version that came out as of the time of recording this just a few days ago. So if we look at the containers that are running, we don't actually have anything running. And that's because we didn't tell it to run anything, but we also don't have any images yet. So if we look at Docker images, you'll see that we have none here. So the first thing that you're going to do when working with Docker is you're going to have to start a base image to work off of. For us, we're going to just pretend that we're just working with the Ubuntu. For that, we'll need to run Docker pull Ubuntu and wait for it to download. Before we move too much further on, we should talk about a few of the terms that are going to be thrown around as we deal with more and more Docker. The first one is images. Images are pre-packaged bundles of changes that you've made to a file system. So imagine you start with Ubuntu in this case, which is just going to be the bare bones operating system. And then if we wanted to build something more, we would apply changes to it. So we would install something new, or we would make a configuration change, and that would become a different image by stacking layers. And then from there, we'll get into the probably the most important thing that we deal with, and that is containers. And that's actually when you take the image and you run it and you make use of that container. So for us, we'll do that right now. We can do that by doing Docker run, and then we'll pass it a few flags to make it interactive. And then we'll give it the command. So we give it the image and then the command name. And this will go and run bash inside of an Ubuntu thing. So we can make sure that we're not running on our Mac by typing uname, and you'll see that we're on Linux. First thing we're going to do here is we're going to make a change and see what happens. So I'm going to echo stuff into test.txt, and then just make sure it's there. Yep, it's right there, right at the beginning. So we'll exit this, and we'll run Docker PS. There are no containers running, but I didn't actually show you what a container looks like when it is running. But we'll go back into Ubuntu and see if we can take a look at what's going on here. So if we run this again and we run ls, you'll notice that the test.txt that we had up here is not here. And that is because every time you create a container or you run an image, you create something that is entirely new. It is whatever the starting point was for that image, but everything that happens while it's running is ephemeral, or it doesn't matter. It just kind of keeps on churning. There are ways to get around that by sharing some volumes or connecting some network things together, but that's a little bit more complicated, and we'll get into that when we talk about Docker Compose. If I split this right now and I run Docker PS, you'll see that we do have a container running. Oh, this is really ugly to look at though, isn't it? So we'll slide this over for a second. And this gives us our container ID, the image that we used, the command that it's running, and how old it is. It also gives it a name, which if you don't provide a name for it, it comes up with some pretty comical names. So this is a cranky Turing. So if we separate this back out, we know that since we ran this container from an image, that it always starts at the same spot, regardless of how many times we run a container using the exact same image. From here, we're going to transition into something a little bit different, and that is containers are cool, images are cool, but what happens if we want to make our own image? So imagine we want to ship somebody Ubuntu, and we want it to come pre-installed with some things. So in my particular case, I want to make sure that wget is there so it's easy to install things. And if we run our Ubuntu image and we run wget, you'll see, oh, it's not there. So that's kind of a bummer. And there's a really neat way of doing this in Docker, and that is through what's known as a Docker file. And then from here, the Docker file is a way to specify the recipe, essentially the steps that we're going to take in order to take an image that already exists, in this case Ubuntu, and turn it into something that more fits our needs, and which in this case is we need Ubuntu with wget, and we need it to always be there. So for that, I'm going to open up Atom, and I'm going to create a Docker file. The Docker file has a slightly different syntax than a normal programming language because it's like more just a series of steps, kind of like a script, except for you don't have the same power of calculation that you would if you were writing something like a Ruby or a Bash script. And you have to follow a certain structure. So the first thing you have to do when creating a Docker file is you have to say what it's coming from. So this is the starting image or the layer that you're going to begin with. So for us, we're going to start with Ubuntu. And then from here, we need to run some things. So everything that comes after run is going to be processed inside. And then, like I was kind of saying earlier, if you install something new, that creates a new layer. So each of these commands will create something, a different layer on top of this. And then our image will actually be the final layer that is created because it was built up of all the layers that existed before it. So for us, we're going to apt-get update and then pass it a few things just to make it a little quiet. And then we will also say apt-get install wget, and we'll pass this just to make it a little quiet too. From here, the other thing you need to have is what is actually going to happen when you run a image. And that is, by default, you can actually just do docker run Ubuntu, and it will go off and run something. I actually don't remember offhand what Ubuntu does when you run it by itself, but you can define a default command. So if it's something that's going to, say you have an image that's going to go and process some data and then close, you can just type docker run my data processor image, and then it'll go off, do its thing, and then just the process itself will die, and the container will go away. So we don't have to do that, but in our case, I want to because I don't want to have to type bash every single time. So I'm going to put this in here to where it's just gonna run bash whenever we do this. So we're going to save it. We're going to bounce back over to our terminal so we can build this. Behind the scenes, I moved us into a different directory, but what you're going to do here is you're going to type docker build. We're going to name our image. So in this case, it's called tagging, but we're going to tag it as wget. And then we're just going to say build with the current context, which means this directory. And then what you're going to do is you're going to look for the docker file that's here. So it's going to go off and figure out everything it needs. And then you'll see these are the steps that it takes. So our first step was to say from this. This represents the layer that is Ubuntu. And then our next step here is run apt-get update, and then also install wget. It goes off and shows you everything that it's installing. And then when it's finished, you'll see that it gives you this. So it created an image here. And then you're going to come down here, and this next step is yet another layer that we're going to be adding to this. And that is to say that you're going to run bash as your default thing. So now if we run docker images, you can see that we have multiple images here, and that is the successful build of the image we just made, which is dubbed git, and then we have the Ubuntu one, which gives you this original SHA too. The neat thing here is you can also see the difference in what we did. So us running apt-get update and apt-get install on dubgit actually installed an extra 46 megabytes worth of space. So let's run our image and see the fruits of our labor here. So if we run IT and we just type dubgit, remember we told it the command it should run is bash. So it should open us right into bash, and we're going to dubgit google.com. And it should just work. There you go. So we went and we downloaded the index.html from google.com with a tool that we installed. And now every time we want to work with something that needs wget, we can run our own image instead of working with the Ubuntu image that didn't have that package installed to begin with. So the last thing that I said we were going to do in this short tutorial is we're going to take our image and we're going to put it on the web so other people can access it. But I'm also going to show you how to find other images that you can work with. So if we go back to their web browser, if you go to hub.docker.com, you can see all of the other images that exist out here. This is looking at my profile page, but if we go to the dashboard here, well, explore, you'll see there are a bunch of different official repositories. So Nginx is one, for instance, that if you just type Docker pull Nginx, it'll pull this exact image. Normally, you have to work off of things by username and then image name. But Ubuntu, for instance, this is the exact image that we were using for our purposes before we installed wget on top of it. There are many of these things. So there are a lot of different things that you need or you might want to work with. Like say you want to play around with Node, but you don't want to install it on your local machine. You can pull the official Node image and then you can go into the container that it starts and run bash in there, for instance, and give yourself a shell so that you can work with Node directly. WordPress, for instance, you can just spin up a container that is already running WordPress and go from there. So if we look back at the dashboard, I have a couple just random projects that I've sort of worked with, but this one, my Elixir IDE, is me experimenting and putting an Ubuntu image out there that had everything I needed for working with Elixir. So I put a text editor in there that I wanted to use and then pre-installed syntax highlighting and pre-installed Elixir for it. So I could just spin this up if I ever wanted to do anything and I didn't have to have Elixir installed on my machine. So we need to push some things up here, and I'll show you how to do that. So if we docker push dubget, you'll see that, I'm actually inside of the container. That's why I'm so confused. Docker push dubget. You'll see that authentication required. And what this did here is it was trying to say, oh, you're going to push to library. So this is for the official packages. And then it's saying, oh, you're not allowed to do that as a thing. So for me, my username on Docker Hub is Keith Thompson. So we're actually going to we're going to tag wget as Keith Thompson wget. And so now if we look at Docker images again, you'll see that I have wget and then I have a Keith Thompson wget. And they're the exact same thing. They point to the exact same SHA. They're just two names for the same thing. So from here, we'll try to push this. Authentication required again. So this is because you need to be authenticated with Docker in order to push to Docker Hub, but not to pull from Docker Hub. So to do this, you'd use Docker login. My username is KeithTops. I'm going to paste in my password. All right, and it logged in successfully. So if we go back and we try to push this again, we'll see what happens. So right now it's going to go off and push each layer, and each layer has a little bit of weight to it. I'm going to chop out the bit while it's uploading, and then we can continue after it's done. Now that it's finished, we can go back to Docker Hub and see if it uploaded properly. Docker Hub isn't the fastest website on the planet, so you have to bear with it sometimes when it takes a while. All right, there it is. So we've successfully gone from having Docker not installed on our machine to installing Docker through Docker for Mac, although there are other ways to install it. To downloading our first image and building our first container, to creating our first image and building a container with that image, and then uploading that image so other people can share. I hope you enjoyed this, and if you did, I would appreciate any feedback that you've got, and if you want to subscribe or like the video, then that'd be great too.